Allah, 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 ma lana maulan siwa Allah. Allah, 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 ma lana maulan siwa Allah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا استجيبوا لله وللرسول إذا دعاكم لما يحييكم واعلموا أن الله يحول بين المرء وقلبه وأنه إليه تحشرون وقال تعالى بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وكذلك أوحينا إليك روحا من أمرنا ما كنت تدري ما الكتاب ولا الإيمان ولكن جعلناه نورا نهدي به من نشاء من عبادنا وإنك لتهدي إلى صراط مستقيم صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي سبحانك لا علم لنا الا ما علمتنا انك انت العليم الحكيم. My dear respected elders, brothers, sisters in Islam, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He alone is worthy of worship and no one else and none other. And we send peace and salutations upon our last and final messenger, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the deen of Islam, we are taught that Islam is that thing, that religion which gives life. Again, we are taught in Islam that this deen of Islam is the thing that which gives us life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala outlines that in the ayat of the Quran that was cited. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to the people of Iman, meaning that we as Muslims have to safeguard this Iman. Why? Because it is the essence of our life. So if you ask a medical professional, you know, a medical person that, you know, what's the essence of my life? They'll say that, you know, building good habits, having a lifestyle which, you know, is of a nature that is not debilitating, you know, it's not destructive to your lifestyle. So they'll teach you things to keep up your health so that way you can maximize and benefit with whatever life you can. But this is something that's a dunya, we think, a worldly thing, that if you want to have good health, you know, your person will exercise, they'll eat right. And of course, this is important because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the body and amana. Because of this body, we have an amana towards it, so we have to take care of it. But before anything else, you know, we have to understand it's the deen of Islam that gives us life. And subhanAllah, if a person does not, you know, make this the essence of their life, then they will have a spiritual decline. So the ulama mentioned that the physical death is not something to worry about, the spiritual death is. So of course, the dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ya Allah, allow us to live upon iman and die upon iman. Why? Because this is something that will translate into the akhirah. If a person lives upon iman and dies upon iman, but without this iman, what good was the physical health? So a scenario would be, if a person lived a very healthy lifestyle, for example, you know, exercise, made sure that, you know, they stayed away from such things as smoking, alcohol, and they made sure they led a healthy, clean lifestyle, but they had no belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they didn't feel the need to worship, or they did not believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or they did not try to uphold their spiritual, you know, iman or life, then what good would the physical benefits do in the akhirah? There is no benefit then. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us that in the ayat of the Quran, as mentioned, we'll mention this ayah now. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu istajibu lillahi wa lil-rasuli idha da'akum lima yuhyikum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that, oh, we have iman. This is something, again, subhanahu wa ta'ala, an address that comes many times in the Quran. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. Anytime Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the people of iman, He mentions their quality of, you know, having iman and having faith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. In other ayahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, Ya ayyuhan nas, O people, O mankind. So it's a greater, you know, a larger address. But this one of iman is khas. It's mentioned that it's specific. For example, if a person doesn't have iman, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the message is for them, but Allah is not speaking to them there. Allah is speaking to the people of Iman, those people who have brought, you know, affirmity in the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Allah is speaking to those, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu istajibu lillahi wa lirrasuli idha da'akum lima yuhyikum. Allah has mentioned that, oh, you who have Iman, respond to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to that which gives you life. إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ, you know, respond to that call, لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ حَيَات, you know, in the Arabic language, you know, حَيَات is life, and موت is death. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means, لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ, to that which gives you life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically mentioned here, this is the thing, Iman, Islam, this is the thing that gives you life. This is the thing that will uphold you in your life, in this dunya and in the akhirah. لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ وَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهِ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what stands between a person and their heart. You know, that qalb, whatever is between that person and Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows whatever is between that person and their heart. وَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهِ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِ وَأَنَّهُ إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, and that too, you will be returned. And that to Him you will be returned. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our return. So, if we look into the pre-advent of Islam, you know, people were, you know, subhanAllah, they were not given this thing of this, you know, blessing, this great ni'mah of Iman. So then they were doing things that were, you know, against the amr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or against the, you know, desires of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were worshipping barely cluelessly. It's mentioned that the people, they're spiritually, they were dead inside. So they would just, you know, subhanAllah has mentioned that they would do tawaf around the Kaaba, because Baytullah was already built before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the people, the mushriks, or the people that would, you know, did not believe in Islam before, or did not believe the true religion, they would just make up their own customs. And they would do tawaf around the Kaaba naked, and they would be stuck in zaman jahiliyyah. They were, again, stuck in ignorance. And this was, you know, bringing about their spiritual decline. You know, the subhanAllah, there's very, very, you know, gruesome things that were being done. They would bury their daughters alive. Why? Because they had no inclination of, you know, what is right and wrong. See the difference. My dear respected elders and brothers, and a reminder for myself, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no one, the person doesn't follow His criteria of right and wrong, look how far a person can go. They used to think that, you know, the daughters were not a blessing. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us that a daughter is a blessing. And then they upheld the rights of women. And yet they say that, you know, Islam, it degrades the rights of women. But they have not learned the deen of Islam. They have not tried to, you know, understand what Iman entails. Islam is something that's, it's a conformity, and it's, if we conform to Islam, the way of life will be better, inshallah. The way of life will be better, simply put. But if a person doesn't learn the deen of Islam and then they follow what these people, the kuffar and the mushriks, have to say, remember, we have to take our deen of Islam from the correct sources, from the Quran and Sunnah and the rightly guided people. We cannot just go online and think, oh, this person has objection against Islam. You know, maybe he's right, maybe she is right. Maybe it's true, maybe that women are not being given their rights. What if there is oppression? Again, we have not truly learned. Now go back to the time of tariq, of the history, before Islam. How were they treating the people? You know, they used to be very prideful, boastful. They used to trample over the weak. And they used to commit, you know, such atrocious acts to the weak. And then they would, you know, degrade their daughters and the women folk of their time and their clan. And Islam taught and weeded all that out. Islam taught that this is the way of living. So safeguarding that Iman is very important. So now going back to the time that we live in today, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to us, again, the address of the Quran is for all time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the believing, you know, people that respond to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to that which gives you life. Now someone can say, well, what is that response? And alhamdulillah, we know the response. So being in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praying before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beseeching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then also not stepping the boundaries, overstepping the boundaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is a boundary for? You know, a boundary is there so a person knows that this is something that not to be overstepped. Today there's a boundary of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for example, as we know, many of some of the brothers here, one that I can recall, mashallah brother, he did itikaf, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept. What are the boundaries of the masjid? What are the boundaries of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can you overstep that? What happens if you do that? You break it. So again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created boundaries for the mu'mineen and mu'minat as well, that you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and there's restrictions upon you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed those restrictions so we do not do damage to our spiritual life. Again, if a person is praying before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then look at how spiritually, you know, uplifted that person will be, especially if a person who prays five times in the congregation in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine the spiritual upliftment, and then imagine a person who has, subhanAllah, abandoned prayers for many years. You know, all of us, alhamdulillah, we're equal. We have all have seen people come to us, and we have came to people and described our spiritual ailments. One of the main causes of people, you know, feeling very spiritually down, and then they have thoughts of, you know, I don't want to live this life, is due to the similar reasons. One is that they've abandoned the prayer, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Another thing is they abandon the recitation of the Holy Quran. Another thing is that they abandon the teachings of Islam, the teachings of the Quran and Sunnah. So then, subhanAllah, it's very hard to build up things, but it's very easy to destroy them. You know, if a person prays for 20 years, let's say 2 decades of his life, and subhanAllah, he's worked so hard, she's worked so hard to, you know, maintain that upon every prayer, they will pray upon the appointed time. And then, you know, subhanAllah, 1 week, they go on some vacation, or 2 weeks they go on some vacation, and then they miss 2 or 3 salah. See how easily things can be disrupted. And shaitan has put that in our head that, you know, you need to work less, you've worked hard enough. Again, this thing of complacency, as they say, that, you know, I've done enough, that comes into the heart, and shaitan tries to whisper that into a person. But the whole life, you know, is supposed to be a struggle to what? Know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then eventually meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's so important that in this life, we're keeping the spiritual upliftment as well. We're keeping the spiritual enrichment as well. The main focus is the spiritual enrichment, you know. SubhanAllah, may Allah protect us from diseases and illnesses. But ask a person who's, you know, spiritually unwell, and they think that their time is not much, you know. Then all they're thinking is to what is going to come after. It's not the sickness that's, you know, necessarily bothering them. A person who has iman, a person who has faith, it's what's to come after that they're concerned about now. But subhanAllah, for us, that's the nature of insan. We tend to wait for everything to go wrong to try to fix things. We have to understand we don't have to wait for that. That's something that, you know, we as people should not procrastinate until that time. You know, a person shouldn't wait till they've, you know, gone to depression and missed years of salah and then try to, you know, think. We should take it right head on. So as soon as a person, you know, feels that there's a spiritual decline in their spiritual enrichment, then a person should seek the means that, you know, I should visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I should give more in charity. I should uphold the ties of my family. I should be more respectful to my neighbor. SubhanAllah, Islam has given us many avenues to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is always the message of every khutbah, every lecture, every bayan, halaqah, that what is our purpose in life? It is to get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so we may become closer to Him. So that when we meet Him, He may be pleased with us. Simply put, if you were to, you know, summarize this life, what is it more than, you know, these few points that are taught to us in the Quran and Sunnah? That, you know, gain the closest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gain the closest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala profusely, you know, make istighfar, you know, repent profusely. Just always do something that makes you engage in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is that spiritual life, and this thing, it carries on in this dunya and the akhirah. You know, one story comes to mind, it's written in a book, it's a very powerful example, and it takes us back to the, you know, pre-modern times. In which, you know, if some of us maybe back home in Asia, Africa, you'll see some villages that aren't as well developed, they have bodies of water which you cannot get across. So because you cannot get across them, there's no infrastructure, there's no road. Because here in America and the West, we're spoiled, right? You put in your GPS, it's going to give you a navigation and a route to get to wherever you need to without any hiccup. It's not going to take your car through a body of water. So it's going to tell you how to get to point A to point B without any hiccup. And it gives you a time. So in pre-modern times, people used to take a boat, people call it kashti, you know, a small boat. They would take that boat and they would ask the person, they would pay him, you know, a fee of a gold coin or some, you know, goods to take them across one body of water to the other. Small, you know, but they can't cross it otherwise. So they need to cross through this boat to get to the next part of the land. So in this book, it's written that there was, you know, 3 people that boarded upon this small ship, and there was a ferryman. A ferryman is a person who, you know, transports a person through a small body of water. He has a small boat, which is called a ferry, and, you know, He paddles it across and gets them to the other side, drops them off and picks maybe people up and brings them back. So that would be their profession, one of the professions of pre-modern time, back in the day, you can say. So this person, he picks up, you know, 3 passengers, you can say, and these passengers are discussing with the ferryman and themselves that, you know, we have studied some, you know, sciences. So one says, I've studied, you know, medicine. The other said, I've studied astronomy, which is, you know, something to do with the stars. And one says, I studied medicine. And then they ask the, you know, person who's always engaged in this boat work that, you know, what's your profession? It's like, you know, my whole life, my father, I remember him to be a person that would transport people across the water. And subhanAllah, that's something I've done as well. My whole life has been this, that I've, you know, transport people across the water. So then, you know, these people, because again, sometimes that's the nature of insan, that when they've studied a lot, when they've accomplished a lot, they look down upon the other person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. They look down upon the person and says, you know, what have you done with your life? If all you've done is this, then what else have you done? You know, we've done this and that, and it's benefiting us today. So, what have you done with your life? You know, you're doing this your whole life, but there's more to life out there. What have you done? And sometimes people look at the Muslims, you know, and of course, alhamdulillah, Muslims are well accomplished in other fields as well, but when they're spiritually inclined to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they disassociate from the world, they ask them, you know, what are you doing? You only have this one life to live. Do something with your life or make something of your life. Always engaging in dhikr, salah, disassociating yourself with society. And we'll get back to these hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi. Actually, we'll mention the hadith of Rasulullah first. Prophet sallallahu said that a time will come that a person, it's better for him to seclude himself, to disassociate himself. It's very important. We think to ourselves that we need to be out there engaged. Remember, the fitna is greater now in today's time. So Allah, Prophet sallallahu said that time will come when it would be better for a person to seclude themselves. You know, more or less to the meaning of the hadith. So going back to this story and ending with the story, that this person, he says, you know, I was doing this my whole life. I was transporting people across the small body of water. So now, subhanAllah, as they're traveling in the small body of water, you know, immediately, you know, hurricane, it comes. And then this thing, the boat is small. Again, these boats that are ferries, they're very small. So they're easy to topple over, and they can, people need to get off the boat. So then, otherwise the boat goes down. It's not the boats of today. So now the hurricane comes, a body of water is coming over the boat. It's, you know, it's taking them off. And subhanAllah, these three people who have learned their whole lives, you know, learning certain professions, they're panicking. And, you know, they're panicking, and the ferryman, he's calm. Because he says, you know, alhamdulillah, I learned how to swim because I've been in this body of water my whole life. So I made sure to learn how to swim. And he said, what about you guys? He's like, no, we didn't ever learn how to swim. He's like, okay, then you guys wasted your life today. The small thing that I learned in my life, it's going to save me today. And all the years that you spend learning whatever you wanted, it can't even save you from this body of water. And then they drowned. So the meaning of the lesson and how it can be applicable today is that, subhanAllah, people, we need to learn how to navigate this body of water, which is dunya. We don't need to associate ourselves with everything else out there in the world besides our deen. And then whatever good we can do for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through our worldly affairs, we should do that as well. There's no problem. We have to learn how to navigate. And that's what the ferryman was telling them. He's like, you don't know how to navigate yourself out of this body of water. You learned all these sciences, but the one basic principle that you needed here today, you failed to learn that. So, you know, my skill set that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me is saving me today, where your skill set cannot save you. So again, the deen of Islam is the saving grace of a person's life and their iman. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that, O you who believe, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing us, alhamdulillah, He has given us the gift of iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing us. And He's saying, O you who believe, respond to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to that which gives you life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, has given us this deen of Islam to what? To better our stance in the akhirah. The Prophet of Allah ﷺ mentions hadith that the dunya, it's for both categories of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives it to those who He loves and those who He does not love. But as for iman, again, we have to safeguard this iman. As for iman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only gives it to those who He loves. So sometimes as individuals, we feel very spiritually disinclined. You know, we haven't read the Quran for a while, or after Ramadan, we have not fasted or read the Quran or prayed salah in the masjid. But Allah, you have to remember that, and I have to remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us iman because there's a close muhabbat. And we should not take that for granted. So that's why it's even more important to safeguard this iman, because we realize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who bestowed it upon us, no one else. If you look at all the, you know, the richest people of today, it's mentioned in the Quran that their mal, it will not avail them on that day. You know, on Yawm al-Qiyamah, their mal, their money, their wealth, it cannot avail them. No amount of money can avail them on that. Avail means no money, amount of money can save them. And it doesn't have to be just money, it could be worldly assets. It could be their children, it could be their families. If a person did not believe in the, you know, the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, if a person did not believe in the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is no saving grace for that person on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And subhanAllah, it's the one true thing that's the savior of both this life and the akhirah. So as a person, as individuals, as a group of people, as the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we should make sure to understand that how important is it to safeguard our iman, especially out there in the world. You know, many of us, you know, the ones who are young, they're in the schools, many of the elders are in the work field. It's no problem. As long as a person understands that the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes first. You know, a person is working, they should make a request that, you know, or have it in their heart that, you know, I do not wish to miss a salah, whether I'm at work, whether I'm at home, anywhere, whether I'm on vacation. Why? Because that would do damage to our spiritual life. So they request their professors, their bosses, whatever it may be, that, you know, I need some time. It's non-negotiable. Because again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never take something away from you that you've done for His sake, that He wouldn't replace something better. So again, if the people, the professionals, they have an ishkal or a problem or a doubt and they cannot, you know, adhere to your request, make sure that, you know, you try your best to make sure that they do. And always make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, put me in the best situation where I can worship You. Oh Allah, make me in a situation that I'm never compromising my deen. Oh Allah, you know, never let it be that I forget Your remembrance in any situation. Sometimes this happens, and you see it in many times in, you know, certain cultures, that, you know, a person can be engaged in ibadat all time, but whenever there's a function or a wedding or a party or anything of these sorts, the first thing that they forget, and we've seen it all with experience, the first thing that's forgotten is the salah. You know, a person that, well, I'm only here for a few hours, I'll just make it up, you know. These are all imtihan, these are all tests from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are we going to be the individuals that, you know, stand out from the crowd and say that, you know, we don't want to do damage to our spiritual life? Again, would a person ever miss work for these functions? No. This is why they, is no coincidence why functions are held on a certain days, Fridays, Saturdays, right? Because people do not wish to miss out on the dunya, their work life. They don't wish to miss out on the maal, the money. But I have to remember that any person who misses out on, you know, salah, and adhering to the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they do great damage to their spiritual life. Prophet ﷺ said that, you know, for example, just one salah, and we'll end with this. Prophet ﷺ said, mentioned that, you know, what person who misses asr salah is as if he has lost all his wealth. And yet we as individuals, we're striving towards the dunya and missing these salahs such as Dhuhr and Asr. Because usually Maghrib is a time, you know, people are getting home or from the events or functions or Isha. So we totally neglect these salah, and we're forgetting that these are the things that are upholding our iman. Again, upholding the pillars of iman is very important, inshallah. Next time, we'll speak about, you know, the sacred months, inshallah, of Dhul Hijjah. And we'll speak about the sanctity of these months and how a person can get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we know, those are the most beloved days to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, you know, if I'm not given the ability, another speaker, inshallah, will speak about these days that they're coming, inshallah, soon. We're in the month of Dhul Qa'adah, and Dhul Hijjah is coming, the month of Hajj. And it's, as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded all of us who is ever able to do so, man istata'a ilayhi sabila, whoever has the means to uphold this journey of the Hajj. Inshallah, we'll speak about that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the correct understanding of this deen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ease the afflictions of all the Muslims across the world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the company of His beloved Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Wa qulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa lisa'il muslimin. Fastaghfiruhu innahu wal ghafur rahim. Jazakallah.